You are entering the Nillyverse with your hosts, Gustavo Kania and Rodney Perrin. This episode has been brought to you by the Society of Namecoin. No. Hello, I think we're...
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you doing, Gustavo?
I'm doing well. I've dressed up for you. Just like you've dressed up. So this week's subsection was entitled "Put something in there," correct?
Something in there.
What are we putting in where?
I think this is our fifth podcast. Well, we had talked about and nothing, and the fear that it creates,
talked about some
difficult notions.
Something in there really talks about the history of ether
and empty and fear and so forth.
I wanted to say something beforehand, if you don't mind.
I just wanted to note.
I think for people who are perhaps listening to us but are also trying to read our book. The book is over 400 pages long, which is a long pathway, but the second half, the whole second half of the book is very practical critique of the popularizers of science and four very specific ways that nihilology can improve the science of popularizers. And I wanted to just mention that, so it may take us a while before we get to the application of nihilology, but the book is intended to have us reflect on sort of the wider issues of nothing and so forth, but then also to apply that to a very specific, well-defined critique of popularizers of science, and give, I think we said something in that transition near the end there, said that it wouldn't be right of us just to critique the popularizers. And I don't know if we've mentioned this yet, but we call them pops. And in a certain sense, we like to tease them a little bit. Teasing is part of the critique.
Yeah.
But it wouldn't be right for us simply to have a critique of popularizers of science, but rather we need to also give very specific ways in which our neological view will help improve their science and actually allow us to look into the nature of the physical world and the nothing world together. So I just wanted to mention that is in that last section, which is maybe 100 pages or more, it's a very substantial piece of work of contributions of nihilology to science. Focuses on four very clear things. One is complementarity. Niels Bohr, way back in the 20s and so forth, came up with this notion of that, especially in the realm of quantum mechanics, not one experiment, not even one measurement can give you the full understanding of a problem, but rather you need to come at that problem from at least two different views. And we have extended that into our own sense of what we call the pattern of knowledge. And we talk about that. In order to understand the world, we need to take on the language, the understanding, the research, the insights of religion, philosophy, and science together. We call that the pattern of knowledge. And how that works relative to complementarity is one of the sections at the end. Another one is called instability of nothingness. And in that one, I mean, originally you brought me into this project because I had studied Asian religions and look at the religious perspective on, or theological, you might say, on nothing. But so in this instability of nothing, it turns out that especially a couple of schools of the East, Advaita and what's called Samkhya, we're very scientific in many ways about talking about how the world came to be. And this instability of nothingness is, if you look at what science is talking about in the West and in modern day, it's very much echoed and improved and extended by these look at Asian religions.
So would it be more fair to say that science is the echo of the Asiatic religions?
yeah, you know, it's older for sure.
Yeah.
But yeah. sorry about interrupting.
Well, this old notion about, you know, that the discussion of Big Bang and so forth, and talking about how nothingness is inherently unstable, is a big theme in that discussion. And we'll see. Mm-hmm. You'll see that is quite clearly talked about, especially in this philosophical summit. The third section where we contribute to science understanding is around the simulation hypothesis. Nick Bostrom, famous for bringing up this notion that evolved post-humans, you might call them, may be interested in simulating their past, and that we are living in that past now. And that sounds very kind of like a video game or sci-fi, but the fact is a lot of serious scientists talk about this simulation game and try to make sense of it. And talk about that quite clearly. Again, we bring in other perspectives and bring in the whole notion of the whole manifest world being a virtual space.
Well, I think that the movie The Matrix really popularized that idea. It was there.
It's amazing how much The Matrix is in science books now, isn't it?
Yeah.
The Matrix and The Terminator are everywhere.
Sure, yeah, that idea, I think, it rings true to a lot of people, right? They don't want to, for some reason, the idea of God, right, it's too scary, right? but the idea of a programmer sort of having programmed this entire Sim City world, right? Something that's more easily digestible, right? So
that's exactly right. Yeah, there's a lot in there about why serious scientists are taking up this notion and bringing in, we'll talk about that later, but yeah,
right.
bringing in notions that sound a whole lot like a creator God again.
Right.
So let me just mention this fourth one. The fourth one is a long section about string theory being one of the ways that people are trying to bring a unified theory of the world together. And string theory, the mathematics is quite complete in string theory, but in order for the mathematics to work, we need at least six more spatial dimensions in the world for it to work. And we have, from a long discussion, I know in the book we asked our readers to please take this path with us with patience, because it's a long one. But in the end, it's a very insightful and unique approach to where other dimensions may be found. And just to give a little hint, it's about utilizing the human eye as a tool of sensation, as an instrument of sensation. Hmm. And I should just mention also that we have an appendix in that section, a completely different approach to extra dimensions that we call realms. And it's based on the observer moving through three-dimensional space, and gives yet another contribution of nihilology to scientific understanding. Mm-hmm. So if you are reading the book and following along, we are going to get to some very practical applications of this as we get near the end. So I just wanted to reassure our readers and our listeners that it's we're going to get there, and they're going to enjoy it.
It's a long path, but there will be roses along the way. There'll be time to take pictures and. Okay. Cool. Great. Thank you.
Okay. So I just thought that might be important for people. If they're thinking that this is going to be a long series, it probably will be a long series of podcasts, but I think it'll be engaging and very rewarding in the end.
So. I think so too. That's why we're doing it.
Okay.
So the section, put something in there. What are we putting in where?
So it's about ether. It's a discussion of ether, which is
with a quintessence of the ancients.
Yeah, from the Greeks.
Well, I think we spoke to some of that like last week, and how it pervaded all of space for a long time. In fact, although there were some people that that might not, you know, that had other models. But the prevalent model of the universe was one of infinite expanse that was filled with a fluid, the ether, and that was true up until the turn of the 20th century. Ether has been used, abused, and maybe discarded, but maybe there might be something to bringing that term back into scientific vernacular. I remember when I was in school, and when they were talking about, you know, in the history of science and the Michelson-Morley experiment, how the narrative back then, and I'm 41 years old, right? So it wasn't that long ago. The narrative was that science proved that the ether didn't exist, right? And it was only until after when I started to actually question these things and took some history and philosophy of science courses that
you can't prove that something does not exist.
It's just not here where we're looking, right? But it could be somewhere else, right? Or, and in the case of the Michelson-Morley experiment, right, the model of there being an ether wind that exists like everywhere, like as some sort of field, right? Well, that doesn't necessarily have to be the way that the ether actually is. It was how we maybe the ancients believed that it existed like a fluid, right, all around us, right? But perhaps the ether stays static around massive bodies. That's why, say, the negative result of the Michelson-Morley experiment was, well, we couldn't notice that that movement through an ether, right? Because the way that the ether sort of exists is different than the experiment was meant to confirm or deny, right?
Right.
It wasn't set up properly for what the ether, how the ether actually exists. Naturally, you know, why this idea kind of stuck around was because, you know, like 15, 20 years later, Einstein's theory of relativity really just invalidated the need for an ether, right? And not much more discussion was done after that. But, you know, I just saw something recently that to Michelson's deathbed, he believed in the ether, right? So much so that Einstein came to visit Michelson apparently when he was gravely ill, just about to die, Michelson's wife implored Einstein not to bring up the subject of the ether, because this is something that was untouchable for Michelson. He didn't accept the null result of his experiments. Anyways, the ether sort of comes and goes, but you start to see that the narrative is changing nowadays, right? Whenever popularizers of science or pops, whenever they bring up the ether, the subject of the ether now, you'll see that they don't say that it doesn't exist, right? But that it's just unnecessary, right? And the reason I believe that they've shifted the narrative, and they've been very clear about that. One is because philosophically they'd be called out, but more importantly, a lot of the things that they're working on could be termed ether, right? Quantum fluctuations. Zero point energy, a Higgs field. Why couldn't that be the ether that the ancients were talking about?
Right.
Well, you know, that you don't have much to argue there as a popularizer of science. Scientists are seeing that there is something beneath the surface that isn't like earth, air, fire, and water. It's something different. But that's, I guess, the only way that I'd like to introduce the ether. Is there anything that you'd like to add to that?
I did. I was thinking, I was rereading this a little bit. As long as we aren't in any hurry, I just thought I would
make
comments. Yeah. So I see you're playing that famous Picasso video.
Are you familiar with this work?
Him painting late in life. Yeah.
It's called the Mystery of Picasso. It's one of my favorite,
he's sitting around in like shorts or something.
That's right. Yeah. And he's there in his studio with Henri-Georges Clouzot.
Oh, is that who it was?
One of my favorite directors, yes. And he's there sort of creating works that after the filming of this, after the filming of which, were thrown away, you know? They were painted for this film and then discarded.
Yeah.
So this is the only place where you can see them, and I put it up there for inspiration.
I like it.
It's been a while since I've seen it,
so I'll let it play.
Well,
I wanted to mention something, Gustavo. You had talked about how ether has found its way into so many types of search for the kind of basic medium of. Filling up emptiness and emptiness zero. And I noted when I was reading back here, I noted this book by William Lynn. It's called Occult Ether Physics, Tesla's Ideal Flying Machine and Conspiracy to Conceal It.
Yes.
And it's a book where he goes through and he gives an actual fact, what he calls a factual history of Tesla's work on electric powered flying saucers.
Hmm.
So there's a whole realm of ether studies that is into the kind of woo-woo magic area. And one of the problems that I ran into when I was looking into is how to separate out all this conjecture about what ether is. But it made it really interesting to think that ether has been such a magnetic notion.
Mm-hmm.
That has brought scientists, that has brought spiritualists, and has brought all kinds of people together to use it and try to look at the world with it. That was one thing that I wanted to note, and I just was sort of fascinated by that. And
mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that you said about using the word ether, the word energy gets thrown around by all those camps too, right? And maybe a scientist shudder at the idea of like a spiritualist using the word energy, right? Because you know, yeah. What do they know of energy and how are they defining it? Some nebulous sort of concept, you know. But these words have a lot of gravitas, right? They are incredibly powerful, right?
Very, yes.
And there's a reason why everybody wants to use them, and everybody wants to use them in the way that they have it defined in their minds, right?
Right. Exactly.
Right. So, yeah. So I agree. Yeah, ether is in that camp for sure.
Right. So another thing that the discussion of energy is also a really big one. I mean, you know, energy has its name in all the religious traditions of the world. You know, the Holy Spirit, Shakti in Sanskrit, Chi in Chinese, Baraka in Arabic, and so forth. So that's another area. But it's also true because it's the kind of thing that people have latched onto, as you say, and they'll use that concept in ways that you just can't tell what you're getting into when you start opening that up.
These concepts are primitive, right? We're drawing them out and we're refining them as we go along, but they're important to us so much so that you know, at least intellectual wars are fought over them, right?
That's right. That is a great point, actually. You just made a really wonderful point, because that's similar to nothing. Isn't it?
Yes.
Nothing is also one of those.
It is.
That has drawn so much thought and so much reflection in the philosophical and religious world, and now also in the scientific world, it kind of, like the word ether, like the word energy, has brought all three of those areas together. And I think that's really, that was a great point, Gustavo, because nihilology, our work, has been to try to work our way through nothing with really clear thought, really clear definitions to make it a useful and clear notion. So I think that was a great point.
It's at least my position that the word nothing is actually the granddaddy of them all. It's the most important word that we need to wrap our minds around or accept, right?
That's right. And we can even, I think one of the underlying goals of our book is that scientists can accept a certain relationship to nothing that will help them become better scientists.
Yeah.
And yes. There was one other thing I just thought I'd bring up because it's a theme that we did looked at a lot, and that was that the basic essential thing that separates academic science from pop science and popular scientists is that the lingua franca of academic science is mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
And that, according to the agreement or the approach of popularizers of science, is that in order to reach an intelligent, educated audience, but not a scientifically educated audience, is that they have to get rid of mathematics. And therefore, they are left with stories and with images in order to convey their meaning.
Right.
So that's one of the things that we were talking about before. They have, by their very own decision, been forced to become good storytellers.
Right.
And that has brought with it great impact, but it's also got them into a whole realm of life that they don't have the slightest idea how to manipulate in a skillful and subtle way.
Yeah.
But anyway, I wanted to just look at language a little bit with Maxwell and Ether. You just point out a couple of things I thought were really, really interesting. One is that, okay, so Maxwell says, okay, electromagnetism can't move in nothing. It must be moving about in something. It must be a wave in something.
Right.
That's where he came up with ether. But listen to his language. He says that electromagnetism are transverse undulations of the same medium. And here's another one. He said that electricity, magnetism, and light are affections of the same substance. This great language,
yes,
of the 19th century is so beautiful.
Very
and
poetic.
Now the popularizers of science are having to again become great language managers in order to convey their meaning. And one of the things we pointed out in the book was that popularizers of science are often resorting to poetry.
Mm-hmm.
To convey their messages, which is really pretty interesting. Going back, and now we see that back in the 19th century, that Maxwell was already very poetic, in a certain sense, we're returning to Maxwell's language. And here's another little point I would like to make here, is that Maxwell was looking for a medium and so forth, and he gave it the name of luminiferous ether. What a wonderful word.
Mm-hmm.
Light bearing air, luminiferous ether. I just liked that. And the kind of the irony that popularizers of science in 2020 are returning to 19th century techniques in order to convey their language for popular readers.
Right. So, people aren't really like latching on to the Higgs boson, even though that's within scientific circles. Yes, they'll talk about the Higgs boson, right? And that's the language, right, that they'll use amongst themselves. But they're starting, yeah, to realize that the war is out there, right? And we have to bring people in, right? So we have to meet them on their, or we have to speak to them on their terms, right?
That's right.
And they like poetry, right? They like the word ether. They like the word energy, right? So let's speak to them on their terms.
That's right. So let me just go. I just go one more point, then I'm done.
Yeah.
So in Michelson, you call him Michael. Is Michelson? Is it Michelson?
Michelson. I'm hedging my bets.
Yeah, I always thought of it. It's all right. It's something else. So we'll call it Michelson because you like that. So he was famous for measuring speed of light. And he started calling ether the ether wind, and it had a kind of a blowing, flowing quality to it, according to Michelson. And he went about, set up to try to measure ether wind. And one thing that he found really interesting in doing this research was that he tried to explain the ether wind to his daughter. And so he made up a whole story about how the ether wind is like a flowing river. And what he was trying to measure would be like a swimmer swimming upstream or swimming downstream, or perhaps swimming from shore to shore. And he did that, he created that story so that his little daughter would understand what he was up to. But the fact is that story was latched onto by the history of science and used over and over and over again to introduce people to the notion of the ether as a flowing medium.
Right.
So anyway, I just thought that was really interesting, because it's a point that we have made in our book about how the popularizers have become storytellers, and they're reverting back to these wonderful stories that were created 100 and 150 years ago, like the ether being like a flowing river. And he did it for his little daughter. So I thought that was really cool. So us readers of popular literature, right, like his little daughter, stories to understand.
There's truth to the idea that as Michelson shared that story with his daughter and maybe with others, he starts to it starts to be the only way that he can sort of imagine the ether, right? That the more he shares that story, right, the right. more it becomes the way that the ether is, and so
that's right.
He gets to the point where his experiment yields a null result, right? He cannot conceive of an ether being any other way, right?
Right.
So that's I'm not saying that that's good or bad. I'm not making a value judgment there. I'm saying that's just how maybe science works in general, and that's the only thing I'll say. That there is a lot more to this, right? There's an actual tool. I think that this can be generalized, I think, further, right? But I'm not going to get into that right here.
That's okay.
But you know what I'm picking at right now. So, but we'll leave it. We'll tease the audience.
We'll get it next time.
And not go any further there. I think you correctly sort of pointed out that my emphasis have been more on the physical, right, and the philosophical, whereas yours are more on the philosophical / theological. It would stand to reason that I'd want to speak to the physical, right, and about the physical theory and such, and where we see it maybe today, its status today, which is not non-existent. In fact, there's work still being done on finding the ether. But actually, what I wanted to speak about was about belief. So a couple of weeks back, I differentiated between what I found to be six nothings, and I wanted to do something similar for belief here, to disambiguate belief, because I want to reserve the word belief, right, for something which cannot be revealed by evidence or reason. Okay.
Okay.
I think it's important to reserve the word belief for something which cannot be revealed by reason or evidence. All right.
Okay.
So when we speak of religious belief, right, that's the only proper belief, which is something which cannot be revealed by evidence or reason. But then, there could be sort of a secular belief, which is really nothing like, say for instance, being pro-choice. That's I think a secular belief that people can have. But I don't want to call that a belief. What I want to do is I want to call that an opinion. Belief here in quotation marks is informed by some evidence, right? Some evidence about the world, right? And about its consequences, its physical consequences, right? Or sociological consequences. So I want to say that that's not really a belief, right? That's an opinion that you hold, okay? Now, there's also philosophic belief, and that would be, your philosophical belief here would be, say, about free will, right? Having free will. Now, that's something that's debated, right?
Yes.
Has been debated for thousands of years, and right. the discussion will continue for another thousand. There will be no end to that debate. Okay. But that is not a belief as well, right? So you can be, you can think that we're all, we have perfect free will, or that we're all, that everything's been predetermined. There's only fate. There is no free will, or something in between. But those aren't beliefs. Those are positions, philosophical positions that you hold. Okay. So we have belief. Proper belief is really only religious belief, right? There's secular belief, which is opinion, right? Philosophical belief, which is a position. And then there is the scientific belief. If a scientist were to say, I believe, in this case, right, something say about the Higgs property of the Higgs boson, then it's not really a belief that he's espousing. It's maybe a hypothesis. So we have, we try to disambiguate there could be others, belief then is really reserved for religious belief. There are opinions, there are positions, there are hypotheses. The only real beliefs are those of religion. Then I have a question, right? Well, in which way can we know something to be true, right? And here I'm really going to not talk about like whether you like ice cream or not. We're not talking about subjective truths, okay? So how can I know that something or X be true, right? There are two ways that I can hold X to be true. That is within some degree of confidence. Say for instance, the percentage of chance of rain. I have a degree of confidence that based on the evidence that it's 68% likely that it'll rain tomorrow, or with certainty, right? I can know X to be true certainly from evidence, like say scientist knows by evidence, a mathematician could know by deductive reasoning, right? Or by faith. That's the other way that we can know something as being certain, right? Now, right. You can quickly sort of imagine like that, well, wait a second, how do you know it to be true just by faith? Well, I'm not saying that it actually be true. A scientist can know for certain that the speed of light is constant, right? They will know that it's certain, but it's not that it actually be true, right? It's possible that the speed of light is not fixed or is not the fastest a signal can travel through space. There might be a possibility, although it doesn't fit theory currently, that the speed of light can be exceeded. Just like there's a possibility that Christ didn't die on the cross and was resurrected three days later, right? That's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is what we hold to be true. Okay. So I can hold something to be true by evidence, by reasoning, or by faith, and that is indisputable.
Okay.
Now, the reason why I bring those things up, which is really what the purpose of the book is, at least my reason for having sort of worked through this for 5 years, and that is, I want for people that cannot believe in anything religious, I want them to perhaps be able to believe in nothing. And it'll be okay if that belief is arrived at by reason, at least for the first step. So if you can't believe in anything religious, maybe, perhaps, you could believe in nothing.
Believe in nothing.
Okay.
That's great. Well, I had never heard you say that quite so clearly. That was really good. Really good.
So I've been working on it.
Yeah. I mean, that's brought out in a kind of extensive way in the book too, about what we have felt that would be helpful for scientists to have in terms of a relationship to the notion of nothing, and belief would be a way of approaching it and would introduce them to a new kind of understanding through belief. I think that's great. I mean, that's really good.
Great. Wonderful. So I think this was a great episode. Fine of things to come. And looking forward to next week.
Okay, cool. See you later.
Great.
Take care, Gustavo.
Take care, Rodney. Bye-bye.
Entering the Universe has been brought to you by the Society of Maine Coin. Until next time.